Welcome to the Cosmic Fuel Pump, your handy-dandy reality processor where we chop up illusion. Are you curious about how to have a good time right now? Well, you've come to the right place. For the next half hour, join Suzanne, our cosmic architect, as she draws up the blueprint of Eden.
Part two of reality is not what you think it is. Part two, no, actually it's part 31, depending on, you know, how many of the shows you've seen before. But we are in a part two of a two-parter in which we are reviewing where things are and where things aren't in relationship to the material world, the world of our bodies, and what's underneath appearances, which does seem to matter even more. So I wanted to start this week by picking up where we left off last week. I told you about a friend of mine. Her name is Pat Haslip, and she's from Oklahoma. She's probably the only awake person in Oklahoma. It's good the show doesn't go there because I might get mail. To the contrary. And if so, more the better, you know. If there's lots of awake people in Oklahoma, I'd be delighted. But Pat Haslip is awake. And I was telling you a story about a friend of mine who had a revelation experience, as opposed to me, who just kind of trucks along, seeing deeper and deeper, moment by moment, as I keep myself focused in the right direction. Well, Pat Haslip had an awakening. All of a sudden, she knew a different world from the one she had known all her life. And I wanted to read to you from the letter that she wrote to me, which is her kind of link with the underground here, out in sunny California. And her letter was really quite beautiful, in which she described what had happened to her some years before when she woke up. And you might think she's a profuse letter writer. This is my diary. And if anybody out there wants to publish a wonderful document, let me know. We're too busy doing the show to do anything about this. But this is called The Cosmic Fuel Pump, An Intimate Diary, How I Get Sane in a Crazy World. And Max and I do it on the word processor, where we process reality to make it clear, you know, to whomever might ultimately get a peek at it. So in here, I have excerpted some of Pat Haslip's letter. Gosh, I do say tongue twisters. So I'll read you the pertinent paragraph. Then, all at once, I began to have this vision. I knew everything I had ever wondered about in my life. I saw that there was another reality behind the one I had believed in, where everything that was happening was perfect. The perfect thing to be happening right then, no matter how it looked to me. I saw all the bad things that had ever happened to me, and I've had a rough life by public reality standards, were not like I had thought, but were actually God's gentle nudges, slowly turning me toward Him. Her life has never been the same since. She's always known since then that whatever happens is okay. She doesn't live in fear and at effect. I wanted to read you one other small paragraph. I have caused most of my own problems by trying to go against the flow of things. My intention is to say yes to whatever God sends me next. Because whenever I am saying no, it is my ego talking, and it has never seen the truth about anything. Of course, the ego is what runs us. Is the illusion, is the act, is the name we've given to that stuff we do until we find out who we really are, till we find out we don't need an act and that we're quite beautiful just the way we are, you know, without pretending to be better. So, Pattis, hi, honey, I'm going to send you this one. Hope you like it. I was talking last week about my tuning in to the blueprint, that this other world, this deeper world, exists. It awaits. It awaits our discovery. And that my life has been about learning, you know, just what's going on beneath the world of appearances. And I wanted to speak this week about a kind of a test. How do I know when I am in illusion or in reality? You know, it's a little tricky. You grow up your whole life in illusion. How do you know when you've hit pay dirt, you know? And you do. I do. Well, the way I know is that I coined a little phrase. You have to have a good time being yourself. When I'm having a good time, what I mean by good time is I'm wailing. I'm not scared. I'm making it up. I'm powerful. I'm causing things to happen. I'm making reality happen. When that's the condition I find myself in, I know that I and God are one. God is not quaking, right? Shall I apologize once again for using the word God? I always feel a little funny doing it, you know? I grew up my whole life calling myself an atheist. But what do we call this reality in which we are one? In which when we land, we come into a harmony with all that there is, with each other. Our hearts just flood. They're open, they're delicious. Life is wonderful. You know, God's as good a word as any for who we are as one. The oneness in which we would create peace on earth. We would create paradise on earth. We would create earth as the Garden of Eden, which is what we try to do here. I haven't talked about that for a couple of weeks. If you've seen the other 30 shows, you might be a little tired of this one. But I always think it bears repeating. The people that I'm with, the people that bring you this show, we are looking at our lives as the metaphor of the Garden of Eden. We're Garden of Eden Productions because Max Eden's the producer. But it's, you know, a happy coincidence because...
No coincidence.
Shut up, Max. No fighting on the set, huh? So I can't think of a better image than one in which we really are having a wonderful time. So back to, which of course, you know, the Garden of Eden did look like paradise. You have to have a good time being yourself. I want to say more about that. It's the checkpoint, you know, for knowing when you're tuned in. But I also want to talk about it as a decision. We can spend our whole lives questing. We can, and should, you know, worthy pursuit. But everything's very tricky. Everything is, you know, the lights on and off, and who knows which is which. The pursuit can itself turn into a game that doesn't serve us, whereby we are, let's say, trying all the time, looking all the time. But in fact, if we are really awake, if we have our lights on, if our lights are on, we can make a decision that says, I have to have a good time being myself. Because at the end of all the questing, at the end of all the hoping, there will come a place where I will either keep questing and keep hoping, or I will be a hero. I will take it on. I will be in reality in such a way that I am serving, that I am giving, that I'm not waiting to get, that I'm not here to take. I'm here to give, not to get. And I promise you, it's a decision. Had somebody told me that and told it to me clearly enough years ago, I would have saved years of pain, I would have saved a lot of money, going after something that I really didn't intend to catch. You know, happiness isn't something you find outside yourself. It's not laying there waiting for you to stumble across it. It's an inner mandate with yourself. It's a decision. I can't bring it down to a better word. Does anybody on the set have a better word for it? That when I and God are one, I can no longer wait. I can no longer complain. So when I know the blueprint, and that the blueprint is that this oneness is the way it is, I'm a fool for doing anything other than choosing, than deciding that I have no excuses. And that, in fact, if I am not happy. Because, of course, we are in a little drama here. It is a game. It is the human game. And even a good decision is not a guarantee of perfection. But it is a guarantee that you will not delude yourself anymore. That you will not be going that way, upside down. Where am I going? What shall I do? I'll spend some money. I'll take a growth program. No, no. Once you have decided that I have to be happy being myself, I have to have a good time being myself. Gosh, I always forget it. It's such a good phrase. You have to have a good time being yourself. Once you have decided that, when things aren't going well, guess what? Don't shell out bucks. Look inside. You know that you know what the blueprint looks like, and you're really an idiot for straying after that. And, you know, why would you want to be dopey with yourself, you know? So once you know, when things aren't going well, you only get to sit in your own little schoolroom here and say, it's up to me. Once you know it's up to you, you're at cause in the universe. Totally owning that space is a place of responsibility for yourself, for everything, and a place where you and God are one. It is your divine essence, and it is what you are here to discover and to practice, and what I am here to discover and to practice. And you're watching me do it every week. I get better at it all the time. Because I've taken it on. I don't want to see the world destroy itself. I'll be a hero. How much are you willing to take on? You know, it's not an arrogance. It's a necessity and a delight. To be serving others is the most delightful way to live. And delight is the object of life. We had a spirit on the show a couple of weeks ago who was absolutely clear about that, a guide from another dimension. Did you miss that one? Are you sorry you missed that one? It was a hummer. And the spirit said that delight is your teacher. It is not frivolous. It is what you are here to experience. So have I covered this point? Does anybody have any more to say about this one? Thank you. Thank you, Steve. So on to the next point. I want to give you a little quote that I like that comes up over and over again. Abraham Maslow, who is a great figure in this progression of discovery in the universe, he's the father of humanistic psychology. He said, capacities are needs. In other words, what the blueprint is, what your abilities are, what you can become, isn't just what you can become, it's a driving force, it's an absolute need. What you can become is a need, you have to become it. And actually, I want to read you a little something that relates to that Emmanuel, our spirit, said. You are possessed of the greatest sensory device that ever has been or will be, and that is the longing in your heart. See, these things are not accidental. There are laws involved in all of this. You are pulled. Emmanuel also says you are guided. We are guided. There are spirits, there are people who have been before and have left, who are our guides out there, and they are helping to pull us. But the pull is also the universal pull. It's the way it is. It's the way we were designed. The longing in our heart is the longing for this harmony, for this place where we can, in a sense, relax, but in a sense, we're also at our most energized, where we are no longer in opposition to the force, but we are the force. We become the force. Doesn't that sound gutsy and juicy and wonderful? Well, I know that it is, and I know all of you must know it too. There must be times in your life when you've tuned into that space, and why do anything else, right? So, okay, next point. I wanted to talk about handling things. Things come down to being very simple. And the great mysticism that we might be frightened by, that we might think we are not capable of, that we have to be born to some special state, that we have to indeed immerse ourselves in esoteric studies, perhaps, to come to these extraordinary places. Well, yes, we do have to keep pointed in the same direction. But I also know that understanding, once we understand the nature of things, reality fills in. It fleshes things out. It comes to you. That's what affirmations are all about. You stick a positive thought out there, and then you live. And then the things that relate to that just build up, and you don't lose them. And they become your guide. You go in the right direction. Cheers. So I want to talk about what I call handling things. I think that our divine self, I think that this place where we have a good time being ourselves, is a place where we are doing no more than what I call handling things. Handling things means that whatever comes in our path, we do a good job at it. We don't go in the wrong direction. We don't blame, we don't criticize, we don't go to sleep, we don't let somebody else do it. We act with impeccability. Now, when I started talking about handling things, talking about doing this show, Zane, fellow Edenite here, said to me, "No, that's not, I disagree with you." And he said, "You don't want to get bogged down just doing lists," because that's actually what we were dealing with at the time, how to accomplish the list. And I said, "No, Zane, I'm not talking about accomplishing the list as handling things. It's not the things I'm talking about, it's the handling I'm talking about, so that things are whatever happens to happen." Oh, I'll read you a nice other quote now that relates to that. I've spoken before in the show about The Year of Living Dangerously as my favorite film. The central character, Billy, is, I guess, more like me than anybody I've ever seen on film, certainly. And I was amazed to see such an unusual character in a popular movie. But then again, nobody did quite understand what he was doing there, so that all added up in the general confusing scheme of things out there. But I understood what Billy was doing there, and I want to, you know, share with you so that you can have the joy of understanding Billy a little better if you don't now. So Billy, who was meddling all the time, who didn't have a job but seemed to be busy all the time, keeping files on people, interfering, not in any bad way, but why was he doing it? Who invited him? So Billy says, in the film, these are quotes from the film, "I support the view that you just don't think about the major issues. You do whatever you can about the misery in front of you. Add your light to the summit light." And then later in the film, he says, well, when he's in a point of absolute frustration, with the lovelessness of the world, actually, and he's pounding the typewriter and he's saying, "What then must we do?" Oh, I love that moment. Why, I wanted to know, what then must we do? What must I do? What must any of us do in the face of this dilemma that, you know, the world is so mindless? "We must give love to whomever God has placed in our path." That's handling things. You know, what do we do when we handle things? Well, we keep our hearts open. We make sure to have a good time being ourselves. We calibrate that way. We know when everything's in harmony, when everything's according to the blueprint, it feels wonderful. And we are giving love to, guaranteed that there's love involved, because we are love. You know, all the messages, all the insights, all the revelations, all the flashes, all the spirits remind us that we are love and nothing but love. Greg was saying, when I was talking about handling things, one of my other buddies here, Greg was saying, he was reminding me of another perspective on handling things from Don Juan, whom I quoted on part one of this two-parter. Don Juan, the, what's he called? What's he called?
A sorcerer.
Right, sorcerer. The books by Carlos Castaneda, the Don Juan books, Don Juan speaks always of impeccability. And impeccability means you handle things. You know, isn't it simple? So what I really understand is that handling things, that taking every moment and treating it as if it matters, staying awake, choosing, and then totally accepting your own choices. Knowing that you were awake when you chose, that you were a loving being, that you're a giving being, that you're a serving being, and you can relax, you're doing the best you can, that's impeccability. And that's the place where you are handling things, and that's the place where, well, guess what? If you want to talk about it all the way at the other end of the spectrum, handling things being colloquial, I call it God at the other end. I call it our divine self. You can't do any better than that. What better can you do than, you know, handling every moment? Am I going to get gonged here? I see somebody's talking into the mic.
Well, Suzanne, I've been impeccable also in keeping time, and you have 5 minutes.
Oh, thank you, sweetheart. Well, okay. What are we going to skip over? Maybe we can do part three of this little opus here. Well, I wrote here, oh, I wanted to say something about nothing mattering at the level of argument. Oh, but I had a wonderful quote about, quote, I'm quoting myself. Handling garbage, this is back to handling. I'm not finished with handling. Handling garbage is better than not handling luxury. Yeah, do you understand what I'm talking about? You could have all the riches, all the wealth, all the everything, and you could be mean and nasty and feel rotten. And if you just handle even the, you know, something awful, you don't want it, you know, you wish it weren't there, but it's there. It's in your path. God has placed it in your path. So what are you going to do? Handle it. And my experience is that if I handle it well, I feel wonderful. Even if it's awful, I feel wonderful. And since that does seem to be the object of it all, you know, what better can we do than just handle things? Actually, I don't want to go on from handling things, and maybe we can get a part three out of all of this, because I want to read to you from a wonderful book. Now, you got it, Steve? This may not look like a wonderful book, right? Helplessness looks awful, right? Depression, death. Look at these bitch fingernails. This is a chewed pencil. It wouldn't invite you to read it, would it? Well, I read something about this book that said it was as good as it is, so I read it. And I read it some years ago, actually. It's by a man named Martin Seligman. Hey, if you're watching, Martin, call me up. I love this book. Now, I want to read you a couple of little pertinent paragraphs. What he's talking about in this book is that, for instance, we all function with a lot of fear, right? And it's the human condition. And what we tend to do in the face of fear is we tend to say to ourselves, oh, this is awful. I'm awful. Things are awful. Fear. Rotten. And what he says in the book is that, oh, no, no, no. Fear is your signal. It's wonderful. Welcome it. It tells you that you need to do something. It's your teacher. It helps you take the next step. It pushes you to the next door. And, you know, since we're here really to take this voyage, welcome fear. See, that's a good way to understand the blueprint. Once we understand, then we don't have to have crippling fear. We can just accept fear rather than fight fear, because absolute acceptance is the key. Understanding the blueprint is the way we become it. Okay, so hopefully he's helping me, I'm helping you understand it. And what this man is writing about in this book is that if fear were not the case, if welcome fear in the face of the things that are fearful, because if you didn't experience fear at those times, you would be experiencing depression. And depression's a wipeout. Fear's a teacher, depression's a wipeout, because depression, by definition, is something in which you go catatonic. You do not move. And I'll read you a little paragraph. In summary, I suggest that what produces self-esteem and a sense of competence and protects against depression is not only the absolute quality of experience, but the perception that one's own actions control the experience. To the degree that uncontrollable events occur, either traumatic or positive, even positive events, if you can't control them, depression will be predisposed and ego strength undermined. To the degree that controllable events occur, a sense of mastery and resistance to depression will result. The game, see, this is the game. If you understand this, you can play well. You don't have to go at effect. You don't have to be a victim. You don't have to be helpless. You can say, wow, fear is my teacher. And I am still in control. I'm running my show. Reach a couple other things. I suggest that joy accompanies and motivates effective responding. And that in the absence of effective responding, that's handling things. An aversive state arises in which organisms seek to avoid. It is called depression. It is highly significant that when rats and pigeons are given a choice between getting free food, listen to this, and getting the same food for making responses, they choose to work. He did all this on laboratory animals, fabulous research. They choose to work instead of to get free food because mastery is handling things. It's not even getting it for nothing. You can get depressed that way. If life falls, a lot of rich people are depressed because they've got it all and they've got nothing because they don't have mastery. And what we're here for is to handle things, to be masterful, to be impeccable, to be our divine selves. It feels wonderful. And that's the clue. If it feels wonderful, you're on it. You're in it. You're of it. You are it. That's the isness. And that's what we're here to discover. Have I got any time to read the next blurb from this book?
30 seconds.
It probably benefits mildly depressed persons to return faulty merchandise to department stores or to ring the bell at the meat counter to get exactly the cut they want. Act. Don't go catatonic. Don't go to sleep. Don't let the boogeyman get you. You know? Be at cause. So I'm getting a wind-up. What do I want to say? To close, I want to say we have to keep meeting like this. You know, come back every week. This is a journey we're on. And help us if you will. Be us if you will. This is us all doing it together. The universe at peace is us in love. And what better goal? So, love to you all. Come back every week. Mwah. Bye. Have a good one.
Now return you to consensus reality, where everyone can participate in creating our world as the Garden of Eden. And remember, if you know what we're talking about, tune in each week, get involved, change reality. Better yet, contact Suzanne. See you next week. Bye.